Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, whenever you happen to be watching this. Welcome to my gaming room. Today we are going to be doing a review of this game, Old School Tactical. I have just finished up a two-video AAR series on my first playthrough of this, and now I'm going to share my impressions of the game with you. Before we do that, one little caveat. You may see me cavalierly flipping this box around during the review. Do not try this at home. This is a special stunt box that is empty. When you get the maps and the counters and the other goodies that come with this game into this box, it weighs a ton. But the good news is that means there's a lot of game in this box, and that's part of what we're going to be discussing today. First of all, why the name Old School Tactical? I thought about dropping the designer a line to see what was up with that, but after playing it, I kind of figured out why it was called that. The trend in tactical gaming the last 15-20 years has gotten away from the old classic Avalon Hill classic combat results table. And so you see in games like Combat Commander and Conflict of Heroes, Band of Brothers, where the combat results are baked in a different way. You compare strengths versus the strength of maybe the other counters, or maybe they have a defensive value, plus they're sitting in defensive terrain, and there might be a die roll involved, but it's added or subtracted, and you have some other die roll modifiers, and there's no real going to a chart. And I think Old School Tactical, the reason it's called that is because it kind of goes back to that combat results table. Although what's interesting to me is this is not really, when I was playing this game, it didn't really strike me as a traditional combat results table like you would see in Squad Leader or ASL or even Retro for that matter. It still uses the two dice bell curve for results and everything. But the way that you factor out how much firepower is being projected into a hex reminds me very much of a game at the total opposite end of the spectrum. It reminds me of Unconditional Surrender, because you're kind of tallying up the factors and you get a number between, I don't know, -5 and +7, and you use that table. So that was a very interesting approach. And kind of makes me want to break out Unconditional Surrender again, which I've been trying to do all summer, but I've been interrupted with this thing hopping along. So I think that was the reasoning behind that. If I'm wrong, Shane, drop me a line here and let me know what your thinking behind that was. But that's my best guess. And is a good name for this, because while I was playing this, and this is one of the things on my good list here, is that when I was playing this game, it really felt like I was playing Squad Leader, not necessarily, you know, one of the ASL versions, but it just kind of took me back to the days of when Squad Leader first came out, and I tore into it and was playing that first scenario, and like, wow, it just gave me that same kind of experience. So good news there. One thing I really appreciated about this game, along with my whole list here, when I was talking about Retro, I talked about how I missed the to-hit rolls and to-hit tables, and how games like Conflict of Heroes had taken that out of the mix. And it's very much present here. In fact, part of the system here uses a series of small cards that help identify each little unit that's on the table, and the one for the armor has something very much like what you'd see in a game of Panzer. Now Panzer, GMT's game that comes in, I think, 4 volumes, is probably my go-to game if I want to play a really serious game involving armor on armor battles. But there was just enough of that in this system that it harkened me back to Panzer as well, and I thought that was really had something going for it. What's interesting also is how it models chaos. You don't see as much of that in, say, Conflict of Heroes, with the willingness of troops, because it uses that strategic point system or whatever it's called. But in old school tactical, it uses that impulse system where both sides roll at the beginning of a turn to see how many impulse points they have to use, and you use that to buy actions, movement, shooting, assault moves, calling in artillery, trying to rally, trying to dig into cover, things like that. And if you watch the videos of my AAR, there were some wild swings in that, especially on behalf of the Russians. There was a turn where I think they had 15 or 16 impulse points to work with, and there was one where they only had three or four. And I really liked that. That was a really neat way of presenting that. I liked it because also because tactics worked. A lot of tactical games, it's just kind of push and shoot and push and shoot, and it kind of feels like a game of Doom or something. But if you're up on tactics and you find and fix, fire and finish, suppress before you move, things like that, it all works really well. And probably, I think the crowning achievement of old school tactical is the melee system. I love this melee system, even though it doesn't seem at first blush much different from what you see in other tactical war games. The difference is in ASL Combat Commander, it's kind of an all or nothing proposition. You roll, and if you win, they're dead, and if they roll, you're dead, and if not, you're stuck in melee. There's just a little bit of difference here, and that makes all the difference in the world to me. It makes it just makes it a lot more fascinating to resolve melee now, because what happens is when you roll, you can get that all or nothing, that sense of all or nothing that happens. But there's a little finesse in there, because a unit that's being attacked in melee can break, or can become suppressed, and if that happens, it moves out of the hex. And so you get this variable quality to the melee, and it really changes up the attitude toward melee. You know, if you've got a big enough stack in some of the other games, you just charge in there and hope for a great die roll and a bad die roll, and it's all over. And in this one, melee becomes really uncertain. And if you watch the video, especially the second part of the AAR, there was that whole battle between a couple of squads trying to take out a Soviet tank. And it just went on and on. They kept charging in and doing damage to the tank, and the tank would shoot back, and they'd get broken and retreat and rally and go back after the tank. And it made for a really really dramatic situation. I had some other melees in there. One I thought for certain the smaller unit was doomed, and the way the die rolls went, they hung in there. It's just I love the melee system in here. I would dare say it's probably the best way of presenting melee of any game I've played at this level. So kudos there for the way that was put together. I wrote route down because at some point when I was playing, I had a Russian squad out in the middle of the street, and they were being fired on by Germans, and they broke. And I am just really used to the old squad leader ASL tradition of if you're out there and you're broken and you don't have cover, you got to go find cover right away. And there's no real provision for that in this game. And what ended up happening, they ended up dying, of course, in a later turn, but they were able to at least try to rally themselves, and they actually managed to find some cover. And that worked out for me. That seemed reasonable. And as I thought this out, it occurred to me that, well, My favorite tactical game is Combat Commander, and there's no real provision for route in that outside of the cards. In other words, if you've got someone stuck out in the middle of the street and they're taking fire, if you don't have a route card, they're not going to move either, and it's still up to a die roll. So route is a very uncertain thing in Combat Commander, and the difference between that and the way it's handled in Old School Tactical, I can't really complain if it's not a if it's not the traditional means of routing out and away from fire. I think it's handled differently in Band of Brothers. When my package of that comes, I'll check that out and let you know. But really, in the grand scheme of things, that's a non-starter. Like I said, I was concerned about it, but it resolved itself well, and I'm pretty happy with the results on it. There's one other niggling little thing about the game that could be a not so good, but really, it turned out to be a non-starter. The game worked out well anyway, and that's the way that they use the one big map for several different scenarios. It's kind of a space saver. You don't have to worry about butting together all those little cardboard maps that you have to do with, say, Band of Brothers. But as you watch the AAR I had, you'll see that there's a moment when I just completely forgot about one of the borders. I managed to stay east and west and south. I stayed within those borders just fine, but I got into a heated tank battle and completely forgot about there being an edge of the board. I don't know if I'll have to put masking tape or painter's tape across the borders when I play, just to keep myself in check. And that was more about me as a player than anything else, really. So I can't really complain about that either. Trying to think of anything else about this game. I think that just about covers what I wanted to say about it. Overall, I like this game. I give it a definite thumbs up, and I can't wait to see what becomes of the next volume, which introduces U.S. forces, which is currently up on Kickstarter. So, yes, I recommend this game. It's got that old school squad leader vibe. Made me nostalgic for squad leader, and in ways maybe I will discuss it at some point in the future. But definitely a nice throwback to those old gaming days, and a great system, and it is just gorgeous. The game, the pieces, it's just a gorgeous looking piece of work. Having said that, definite recommendation for Old School Tactical, and it's going to end up on my gaming table again, probably frequently in the future. That's it for now. I'm going to be moving on to some other projects. Maybe I'll finally get Unconditional Surrender on my table. We'll have to see how that plays out. If you like what you have been seeing, don't forget to like, and if you haven't done it already, subscribe. That's always appreciated. And we'll see you down the road with more, hopefully, thrilling and exciting after-action reports and play-by-plays and things like that. So, thanks for watching, and in the meantime, may all of your die rolls be appropriately high or low. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, whenever you happen to be. Well, it weighs about 100 pounds, along with everything else that comes with it. Actually, the third map is a Stalingrad map that was a. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, whenever you happen to be watching this. couple of goodies to get in the box. This thing weighs a ton, and you need to put it maybe on the bottom shelf of your game shelf just to support all the weight that comes from that. But I guess that's my little bit of fun for...